Welcome back, students. As we were discussing the second chapter of biology, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants, and I have already told you about the structure of stamen and the process of formation of male gamete, that is pollen, by the process of microsporogenesis. In the today's video lesson, we are going to learn the structure of pistil or carpel and the process of formation of female gamete. The process is known as megasporogenesis. Let us begin the session. The structure of pistil or carpel. Okay, we know that the female reproductive part of the plant is called as gynoecium. Okay, so gynoecium consists of carpel or pistil. Okay, so if a particular flower, okay, or a gynoecium consists of single pistil, okay, if it consists of single pistil, the particular flower is called as monocarpillary. Remember this, mono meaning single. If there are more than one carpel or more than one pistil, then it is called as multicarpillary. Everyone knows mono meaning single, multi meaning many. Very easy to remember. Okay. Next, if a particular flower is having many pistil, that is called as multicarpillary. And if these pistils are fused, okay, they are fused together. I'll show you the picture here. Then fused meaning seen. So the particular flower is called as seen carpus. Okay. And if carpels are free, they are not attached to each other, they are not fused. Okay. Then it is called as apocarpus. Okay. Let me tell you all the picture. Let me show you all the picture here. Okay. Look everyone here. If the particular flower is having only single pistil, it is called as monocarpillary or monocarpillary. And if it is having many carpels, see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, many, more than 2 or more than 1 we can say, then it is called as multicarpillary. Okay. Then I told you, if the carpels or pistils are fused, they are together. Okay. Then the particular flower is called as seen carpels. And if they are free, see here, they are free. Free carpels. So they are called as apocarpus. Okay. The flower is called as apocarpus. Okay. Now let me tell you the structure of pistil or carpel. Pistil, a typical pistil has three parts. Okay, see here this portion. Okay, like this pipe like and the round structures. That structure is called as stigma. Okay, so pistil has three parts. The very first portion is called as stigma. We say that stigma is the landing platform for the pollens. Okay, so this is the stigma. The pollen comes here. Okay, and they sit on the stigma. So we say that stigma is the landing platform for the pollens. Next, there is long slender structure. Okay, the structure is called as style. The second portion of the pistil, stigma, style. And at the end, the where the style ends, there is bulged portion here. Just see here, bulged portion, okay, swollen portion. And that portion is called as ovary. Okay, so a pistil or carpel has three parts, stigma, style and ovary. Okay. Now, inside, now let me tell you all what is there present inside the ovary. Okay, if I take the cross section, if I take the transverse section of ovary, I will be getting different parts, different regions in the ovary. Okay, and then there will be inside female gametophyte. Okay, imagine if this is the ovary. Okay, the bulge portion is the ovary here. Okay, so can you see here, and there is a cavity. See, I'm putting my hand inside, so this is the cavity, right? That cavity, okay, is called as ovarian cavity. Very easy to remember, ovary and cavity is called as ovarian cavity or locule. Okay, now in the locule there will be ovule present. Okay, so that structure, a brief structure, or not a diagrammatic actual section, a simple structure I will show you on the board, that will be easy for you all to understand the structure of the ovary. Okay, so just see here, if this is ovary, okay, so this is the ovary. Now, in the ovary, there is a cavity that is called as ovarian cavity, or it is also called as locule. Okay. Now inside this locule there is a structure present called as placenta. Okay, there is a structure called as placenta. Okay, now in the placenta there is megasporangia. Okay, so in the placenta there is megasporangia. Okay, now this megasporangia is connected to placenta. Okay, there is a connection here. Okay, so I'll just draw a connection here. If suppose this is the connection, so megasporangium is connected to placenta by a stalk like structure, a pipe like structure, and this pipe like structure is called as funicle. Remember, okay, this pipe like structure is called as funicle. So megasporangia is connected to the placenta by means of stalk called as funicle. Okay, now this megasporangia is connected to this funicle. So this portion, the region between the megasporangia and the funicle, this region what I am highlighting right now, okay, this portion is called as hilum. Got it? See, ovary, then there is placenta. In the placenta there is megasporangia. Megasporangia is connected to placenta by means of stalk called as funicle. Okay, then funicle to this megasporangia is having a region here called as hilum, a swollen portion called as hilum. Okay, now this hilum, okay, or this entire structure megasporangia will be having, or that this entire megasporangia itself is called as ovule. Okay, so again if I want to tell here, there is ovary, then there is placenta, and what is this is ovule. Okay, ovule connected to placenta by means of stalk called as funicle, and the bulge portion is called as hilum. Megasporangia is nothing but ovule, remember this thing. Okay, if a particular flower is having single ovule, okay, there is only one ovule, okay. Now there are some cases, the flower, typical flower or typical ovary will be having many ovules, and you know that ovule will after fertilization will form seeds, okay. So the particular fruit which will be having many seeds, okay, meaning that particular ovary will be having many ovules. So if I want to tell you all examples, you are eating watermelon, right? So watermelon, a single fruit itself is having many seeds. Ovule further leads into seed, right, after fertilization. So many seeds meaning many ovules in the ovary. Okay, so example, ovules will be have in a particular ovary, there are many ovules. Example is papaya, also many ovules, many seeds. You can see watermelon, orange, lemon, okay. And if there's only one, the mango example, there's only one seed, right? So there's only one ovule inside. Okay, now again I will tell you in detail the structure of this megasporangia or the structure of the ovule. Okay, so I'll just show you the picture here. This is one more picture showing you all the structure of ovule. Okay, see here. Imagine this is the entire ovary. In their ovary there is placenta, white portion is placenta. Okay, what is this is the ovule. Okay, highlighting is the ovule, and ovule is connected to white portion by means of stalk, that is called as stalk, called as funicle. This portion where ovule is attached to the funicle is called as hilum. See, this portion is called as hilum. Okay, now come back here. This ovule is surrounded by two layers or two envelopes, and these two envelopes, see here, this one envelope, this is another envelope, two envelopes. Okay, these envelopes are also called as integuments. Envelopes are also called as integuments. If I want to draw here, okay, see, outer integument, okay, and okay, so this will be outer integument, this will be inner integument. So if I want to tell you here, this will be outer, see here, pictures it is showing outer integument and inner integument. Okay, but just see here, there is outer integument which is continuous, inner integument which is also continuous, but see here this portion where it is not present. Okay, so there is ovule, but that ovule has the covering integuments, but that integuments at one point this integuments are not present. Here you can see the portion here, integument is not present, and that portion, okay, or that region is called as micropylar region or micropylar. See here, micropylar pole is given here. Okay, so this portion is called as micropylar portion. Okay, and the opposite portion of micropylar region, okay, so this is micropylar, this is micropylar portion. So exactly opposite of the micropylar portion is the chalazal portion. Okay, so micropylar and chalazal. Micropylar portion meaning the portion wherein there is integument, absence of integument. Remember this. And opposite to micropylar is the chalazal end. Okay, see, chalazal pole and micropylar pole. Okay, then now let me tell you again here, in the center or in the ovule, now what is present is the mass of cells. There will be many cells present like this. Okay, there will be mass of cells present, and this mass of cells are called as this. Okay, what I am drawing right now, mass of cells meaning group of cells, and this group of cells are called as nucellus. Okay, they are having abundant food reserve present inside. Okay, so that gives the nourishment to the developing embryo inside. Okay, so again I'll tell you the structure. There is ovary, then there is placenta, inside there is ovule or megasporangium. Megasporangium or ovule connected to placenta by means of funicle. Okay, junction wherein the ovule is connected to funicle by hilum. Okay, the junction is called as hilum. Then I told you ovule is surrounded by two envelopes, outer integument, inner integument. These integuments are not present here. That portion is called as micropylar portion. Exactly opposite, the basal portion is called as chalazal portion. Okay, and the center of this ovule, okay, or inside the ovule, there are group of cells, and this group of cells are called as nucellus cells. See, within the ovule, mass of cells are present. These cells are called as nucellus cells. Okay, nucellus cells are having abundant food reserve material, so that gives the nourishment to the developing embryo inside. Okay, in the nucellus, what is present here is the embryo sac. See here it is shown. In the nucellus, there is embryo sac present. So nucellus and embryo sac. So embryo sac is formed. How embryo sac is formed, that I will tell you. Okay, so what is present here is directly the picture is shown is embryo sac, but there are some cells present here. Okay, there's only one cell. Okay, if I want to draw here like this. Okay, the major central cell. Okay, this cell is now called as megaspore mother cell. Okay, the cell is called as megaspore mother cell. Okay, now let me tell you the second part of this particular video, the process. The process is megasporogenesis. What is megasporogenesis? Process of formation of megaspore, okay, from megaspore mother cell. So there is megaspore mother cell here. From this megaspore mother cell, how the megaspore is formed, how the female gamete is formed, that process is called as megasporogenesis. Okay, so let me rub entire diagram, and then I will tell you how exactly this particular structure, how exactly the megaspore is being formed. directly drawing megaspore here. Okay, megaspore mother cell. Okay, megaspore mother cell, which is always diploid. Okay, it will be having one nucleus which will be a diploid. Okay, but you know that gamete should be haploid, so division should take place is meiosis, reductional division. Okay, these megaspore mother cells undergoes meiotic division. Okay, but you know that meiosis has two stages, meiotic 1 and meiotic 2. So after meiotic 1 division, this cell will be forming like this. In the cell there will be two nuclei, okay, and that will be haploid. Now this was diploid, haploid. Okay, two nuclei have formed, and this structure is now called as megaspore dyad, two dyad. Okay, now meiosis 1 is complete. Now this nuclei will be undergoing second meiotic division, and that will give rise to 1, 2, 3 and 4. You know that at the end of meiotic 2 division, there are 4 daughter nuclei produced. So 4 daughter nuclei have produced. Okay. And this stage is now called as megaspore tetrad. Okay, so there was megaspore mother cell which was diploid, and now what you got, all are haploid nuclei, and this particular stage is called as megaspore tetrad. Okay, if you remember about microsporogenesis, there was this stage, microspore tetrad, and each cell of that each nuclei of that microspore tetrad was having ability to develop into a pollen grain. But here what happens is 1, 2 and 3, out of this 4, 1, 2 and 3 are degenerating. Now which 3 nuclei are degenerating? Normally the nuclei which is present near to micropylar end. Near to micropylar end, this is chalazal end. Okay, so these 3 nuclei are degenerating, and only one nuclei, only one particular stage, or only one particular cell is active, or it is functional. Okay, and only one, okay, this particular stage or this particular cell that is functional, that only give rise to embryo sac, that only give rise to female gametophyte. That's why this entire process is called as monosporic development. Okay, mono meaning single, only one nuclei is giving rise over here, so it is called as monosporic development. Okay, let me just quickly revise. There was microspore mother cell which is diploid, undergoing meiotic division. At the end you are getting 4 nuclei, and that particular stage is called as megaspore tetrad. Now out of this 4 cells, 3 cells or 3 nuclei are degenerating, and only one is functional, only one is giving rise to embryo sac. That's why the process is called as monosporic development. And the process of formation of this embryo sac later, okay, from microspore mother cell is from megaspore, the process is called as megaspore mother cell, the process is known as megasporogenesis. Okay, all this thing I have shown you on the picture. That is megaspore dyad formed first, then megaspore tetrad is formed. Out of this tetrad, only these 3 are degenerating, and only one is functional. And that one functional, only one functional megaspore is giving rise to female gametophyte. That's why the process is called as monosporic development. Okay. Now the thing comes here. Okay, so again this structure you remember, and I will tell you what happens next. Okay, so the function, okay, the functional, what is this, is functional megaspore. Now this is called as functional megaspore, and 3 are degenerated. So I will draw only this now. Okay, there is only one nuclei present here. Okay, this is the functional megaspore. Three are degenerate. There was one here, there was one here, there was all these are degenerated. Okay, so this is micropylar end, this is chalazal end. What happens over here is mitotic division takes place, and mitotic is equational division, right? This nuclei undergoes mitotic division. So what happens, from one, two nuclei are formed. Okay, so from one, two nuclei are formed. Mitotic meaning equational division. So there will be n number of chromosome, n number of chromosome. Okay, first mitotic division. Then another mitotic division takes place. So there was one cell over here. From one there will be two cells. From one there will be two cells, four cells, or four nuclei have formed here. Okay, there are not cells. We cannot say cells because cell wall formation doesn't take place here. So another mitotic division has taken place. Again, there is mitotic division takes place. So let me draw here a cell. There were two. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and again here 3, 4. All are N. So here also N. Okay, so total 8 nuclei have formed. See, there was only one monosporic development, only one megaspore. From that one megaspore, 8 nuclei have formed. So first mitotic division, second mitotic division, and third mitotic division. So there are three successive mitotic divisions. After three successive mitotic divisions, what you are getting is 8 nuclei in a single cell, in a single megaspore. Okay, now what happens is, after formation of these 8 nuclei, 6 of the nuclei is getting cell wall. Okay, and after they are getting cell wall, imagine, suppose if I am drawing a cell wall here, there is cell wall here, there is cell wall here, cell wall here. Okay, cell wall here, cell wall here. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Only 6 are getting cell wall. Okay, whereas 2 nuclei are not getting cell wall. Okay, so we can say that 6 out of 8 are getting cell wall and 2 are not getting cell wall. The 2 nuclei which are not getting cell wall, they remain at the center. Like this. Okay, they remain at the center, and remaining 6 are arranging themselves in different manner. Okay, so imagine this is the structure, and this structure I am telling you all how the cells are getting arranged in this particular embryo sac now. Okay, so let me draw the structure of embryo sac. Okay, suppose this is the embryo sac. I told you this nuclei, 2 nuclei, okay, are not getting cell wall. So these are the nuclei, one nuclei, another nuclei. Okay, now remaining are sac 6 which are getting cell wall. Okay, out of that 3, this is the micropylar end, this is the chalazal end. Okay, the 3 goes out at the micropylar end. Okay, so somewhat like this, 1 cell, second cell, and the third cell which is at the center. Okay, and they are having nuclei, 1, 2, and 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are done here. These 2 are not getting cell wall, but whereas these 3 are getting cell wall. And micropylar end, these cells are now called as, this entire cells are now called as egg apparatus. Okay, this 3 cells are called as egg apparatus. Okay, now see, 5 are done, so remaining 3 goes at the chalazal end. Okay, 1, 2, and 3. And they are having nuclei, 3. Okay, and these 3 cells which are forming at the chalazal end, or they are going, arranging themselves at the chalazal end, these 3 are called as antipodal cells. Okay, they are called as antipodal cells. These are called as antipodal cells, and the cells of egg apparatus also have some names. Two cells, these cells, okay, these 2 cells are called as 1 and 2, these two cells are called as synergid cells. Okay, these two are called as synergid cell, and at the center this cell is called as egg cell. Okay, so what egg apparatus consists of? Egg apparatus consists of two synergid cells and one egg cell. Okay, this is very important. You should know what egg apparatus consists of. It consists of two synergid cell and one egg cell. Okay, so there are three cells which are getting cell wall, three cells which are getting cell wall at the chalazal end, whereas two nuclei which are not getting cell wall. Okay, and they remain in this main central cell. Okay, so there is one central cell which is having two nuclei, and these two nuclei are termed as polar nuclei. Okay, so now this is the structure of embryo sac. Now the embryo sac has formed. Okay, so how many cells are there in the embryo sac and how many nuclei are present in embryo sac? Let me just tell you, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the main central cell 7. Okay, 7 cell, how many nuclei? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So a typical embryo sac is having 7 cell and 8 nuclei. We say that embryo sac or female gametophyte is having 7 cells but 8 nuclei. Okay, so these are the 7 cells and 8 nuclei. Only these 2 polar nuclei are not getting cell wall, so that's why they are remaining in the central cell. Okay, all rest 6 are getting the cell walls. Okay, so let me just brief you all here. Okay, I told you that after 8 nuclear stage, cell walls are being formed. Okay, and 6 out of 8 nuclei are surrounded by cell wall. Rest 2 are not getting that, not surrounded by cell wall, and they are called as polar nuclei. Okay, so again, as I showed you the picture, first there were 2, okay, from then there were 4, then there were 8. After 8, there is the structure formed like this. I have already drawn this structure on the whiteboard. Now, one thing I will tell you here is, what is on the top? If you remember, there is present integument, there is funicle, hilum, and all that thing. Ovary is present here. Okay, this portion, synergid portion, is having a gate-like structure present here. Okay, like this. Okay, and this gate-like structure is called as, synergids are having gate-like structure, and this gate-like structure is called as filiform apparatus. Okay, this filiform apparatus is guiding the pollen tube to come inside, and then the pollen will be releasing the gametes inside. The pollen will be releasing its nuclei inside. So this acts as a gate opening, okay, portion. So filiform apparatus will open, will help, or will guide the pollen to come inside, or will help the pollen tube to come inside. Okay, as I told you, say filiform apparatus, this helps in guiding the pollen tube into the synergid. Okay, this is the picture I have shown you. This is the opposite. Okay, chalazal end having 3 antipodal cells. Micropylar end is having 2 synergid, 1 egg cell, and polar nuclei. Okay, so total 3 cells, 4, 5, 6, then a main central cell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 8 nuclei. So, embryo sac is having 7 cells but 8 nuclei. That's it for today. Tomorrow or the next video, upcoming video, I will tell you about the double fertilization in the flowering plants. Okay. If you have any difficulty, you can ask me in the comment section. And please subscribe for the upcoming videos. Thank you, students.